Hello and welcome to the Retro Hour podcast, episode number 47, your weekly dose of retro gaming and technology news with me, Dan Wood.
Me, Ravi Abbott.
And me, Joe Fox.
And who is that really intelligent guy in the corner?
It's not me.
It's definitely not me.
Ravi sporting his new spectacles.
Oh, God.
Looking very stylish today.
Four eyes. I came in, I was like, who the bloody hell's that in the corner?
I look even more nerdier.
It suits you. I like it.
No, yeah, I think you look good, man.
Yeah, well, now, we are recording this. Obviously, it's technically Black Friday today, I suppose, you know, the time this comes out.
I've got all my Christmas presents on Amazon already.
See, Black Friday, something weird that's, like, you know, come in the UK in the last couple of years. I still don't quite get why we do it, considering we don't have Thanksgiving.
Yeah, I find it's a bit odd, but I'm surprised by the fact that Ravi said that he's got all his Christmas gifts already because of, this is crap, like... I could get a toothbrush, I guess. Like, but nothing I actually want in the moment's reduced.
Yeah. Like. I only got two presents.
That's all you have to buy, isn't it?
Yeah. Mum and Dad.
If you are having a break from people fist fighting in Asda to buy a 50 quid Polaroid TV, then thank you for checking out the show this week. And it is Christmas coming up soon as well. Now, we've been thinking, obviously, like in four episodes, what have we been doing the show like an entire year?
Insane.
Which is nuts. And we thought, what are we going to do for Christmas? So we've come up with a little idea of what will hopefully be an annual thing. The annual Retro Hour Christmas Quiz.
Hey.
Hey, I'm going to batter you all.
It's going to be an hour of quizzing, and we're going to video record it, hopefully.
Yeah, yeah.
As well.
So I think Christmas jumpers are compulsory.
Oh, great.
Beer and mince pies.
And glue wine.
Blue wine, yeah.
Mold cider.
So, yeah, this is coming up. It's going to be the week of Christmas. So, you know, the episode that comes out just before the Christmas weekend. That should be a bit of a giggle, shouldn't it?
Yeah, it'd be good.
I imagine that we're going to get slightly more slurry as the show goes on that week. But,
yeah. Yeah, watch out for the editing with swear words. That's going to be...
Now, obviously, the Retro Hour podcast would not be possible without your very generous donation every week as well. We do have a little link on the front page of our website, theretrohour.com. Obviously, everything we get... through the website, goes back into the running of the show, you know, SoundCloud subscription, server costs, website,
Ravi's
logos.
Glasses.
Yeah, Ravi's very stylish glasses, which he paid for himself. Where did you get them? At eBay?
eBay, yeah. They look like these kind of NHS ones. You know, the big fat.
I genuinely thought they were like on the NHS.
Didn't want to say anything.
I know. I genuinely thought like he'd been, like, you know, prescribed them or something.
I'll invest in a better pair in the future.
I like them. I think they look
good. I'll probably break them in a week.
But yeah, thank you so much for your donations this week. I've got to say a huge thank you to Kim Jorgensen
and Aidan O'Lone,
who both made very generous donations. If you'd like to as well, of course, it all goes back into the running of the show. All you got to do is click on that PayPal link. You'll find it on the front page of theretrohour.com. Now, every week on the show, we do strive to bring you the best guests, veterans of the video game industry, and we've got an amazing guest this week.
This guy, Steve Turner, you know, he helped found Craft Gold and made some amazing titles. You remember Rainbow Islands, Fire and Ice? And this guy's worked with every publisher. Telecomsoft, Sega, yeah. Virgin, Renegade. It's insane.
Well, Craft Gold did some amazing games throughout the 80s and 90s, and he's such an interesting guy as well. So
yeah, and you know, the arcade conversions that they did were just such high quality and standard. It was like some of the best stuff that came out on systems.
And there are some good stories as well about you know, Telecomsoft. They weren't the easiest company to work with, apparently. So
it was a British telecoms
company.
Yeah.
Very random. Yeah,
the world. That's a bit random.
Yeah, so Steve will be telling us all about that. Steve Turner, one of the founders of Craft Gold, he's going to be on the Retro Hour in around 25 minutes from now. Now, let's get into this week's stories. Obviously, you know, it's been Thanksgiving week and Black Friday and all that in America as well. A lot of people doing Christmas shopping. And the NES Mini, obviously a story that we've been covering since it first got announced. Apparently, there's a worldwide shortage of them.
Yeah, I've seen that. everything I've seen is they've just sold out everywhere. Like, I didn't pre-order one. And I thought, oh, yeah, you'll just be able to pick one of them up for Christmas or just pick one up. Didn't think they'd be that popular, but everywhere sold out, like everywhere. Like, I, you know, Google it for like shops in Nottingham and everything, and it's just not seen one, don't know anybody who's managed to get a hold of one. And watched a few reviews online, and they've all said like how difficult it's been for them to get a hold of. I was watching a particular YouTuber the other day who owns a game shop and said that he ordered 90 of them and they got sent two. So one for himself and then one for the shelves.
Well, there's a few eBay really expensive ones that have been appearing as well.
Some go for like $5,000.
Yeah.
Some people are listing them for. It's
I saw one for like one. Somebody had listed it for like £1,800, and I was just like, oh, don't be so ridiculous. And then you're going on eBay, and they are like kind of around that price.
Well, there is an article here on Polygon, and the headline is, the NES Classic Edition shortages prove either one of two things: Nintendo is underhanded or incompetent. Now, If you look at it, I think, though, I mean, there are some people that are speculating, and what you said there about a game shop only getting delivered two of them will probably add a bit of credence to this, that Nintendo are intentionally making a shortage of stock to increase demand.
I would completely agree with that because of, obviously, when Amiibo came about a few years back, they did the exact same thing. And it all stems back to the 80s as well, you know, with like the microchips and everything with the NES cartridges and how you had to use their stuff. And it was always a shortage, inverted commas. So this is something which has been happening with Nintendo for 30 years. And once again, it's just happened again. You know they've got something really good, what everybody's going to want, whether that be customer or, you know, publisher or something. And they probably have thousands of them, you know, already made, and they're just not sending them out because they want the hype and they know, you know, people are going to want it. But what also gets me as well is when it was announced, it was said it was going to retail for like $39.99 and it was $49.99, like, which I thought was odd. I don't know if that's just retailers upping it and everything, but I've not seen it cheaper anywhere online than $49.99, which is still a good price. So I'm not complaining.
Yeah, better than the $5,000 on eBay.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
I reckon also they've probably got Wii U's completely in all the stores and tons of stocks of that. So they may be thought.
Like, I'm waiting for them to come down and they just won't because that's just Nintendo through and through.
Yeah, no one's going to buy a Wii U this Christmas, though, let's be fair. But I think with the NES Classic, you made a good point there about, you know, the Amiibos. And I remember, you remember when the original Wii came out that Christmas, like 10 years ago? That was, I remember then how scarce they were. Everyone was trying to get hold of them for Wii bowling and all that.
The Wii Fit as well, the balance board. Like, nobody could get a hold of them. And they were meant to be like 50 quid when they came out. And like, everywhere was selling them for like 80 quid because of you couldn't get a hold of them. And it was, you walk through town and game shops would have the sign, you know, with the chalkboard, like, oh, we've got so many in, like, manager's special, $99.99. It's just like, well, that's not special. Manager's rip-off, pull my pants down while I walk in.
But it's, you know, the thing is, it is quite a shrewd move, and it does obviously work.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, you know, Ivan wasn't really interested in it at all, because I've got original NES, that's fine by me, I've got an Everdrive
it. Same,
and I was like, you know, I'm not really interested, but now I've been seeing because everyone's like, I want one, I'm like, well, maybe I want one too.
I'm exactly the same. I was like I said, I didn't pre-order one, I might pick one up at some point. And now there's all this hype, and I'm just like, I need it!
They've turned it into that desirable item, haven't they?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Actually, speaking of this, there was some other mini NES news that came out this week. It's been hacked already.
Yeah, I've seen that.
Well, this is great, because Nintendo hardware never usually does, because it's always closed up, but they've had to use Linux for this, haven't they? So,
well, apparently this runs on a Linux foundation anyway, the found. It's ARM-based.
And so it runs on an open-source system anyway, so...
And Nintendo have apparently kind of released that to developers, kind of, you can get the source code and stuff on it, but they managed to get Ubuntu running on it. Now, they're saying, you know, obviously, at the moment, it's kind of a closed platform where, you know, you can't download any more games to it or anything like that. But now they've got Ubuntu running on it, I suppose technically it means, you know, if you can add extra storage to it somehow, you could load, like, you know, other ROMs and stuff, I imagine.
Other emulators. You could have a Mega Drive emulator on there. Or...
But what they are saying is, though, apparently the guys that have done this are just doing it for the sake of doing it, and they're not really interested at the moment in, you know, trying to get extra games and that kind of thing on there. So they're saying they're just doing it for the heck of it because they're not meant to, kind of thing.
Yeah.
But I do love the top comment on this article on Ars Technica. I imagine someone will have Doom running on it within the week then.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
So if you do manage to get hold of a NES Mini, you know, we'd be interested to find out, first, where you got it from.
Yeah.
And secondly, what you think. Do drop us a tweet at Retro Hour UK or on Facebook. We'll pop the links on our website at theretrohour.com. Now, since we're on like a Nintendo kind of vibe at the moment, do you remember Mike Tyson's Punch-Out?
It was a classic, wasn't it?
Well, just,
it?
Or just Punch-Out, one or the other.
Well, of course, you might remember the music. Went like this. Yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
I'm nodding our heads in the studio.
Yeah. I think AVGN did a wicked series on Mike Tyson as well.
Well, there's a podcast called the 30-2010 podcast, and they've actually realised that the music from Mike Tyson's Punch-Out actually came from a Gillette advert from 1958. Do you want to hear the original?
Go on, then.
And it's got words.
This is like one of those proper old war style.
British parfait.
Yeah. When he gets
Are
to the
you
singer.
Doing your bit?
He's even got boxing gear as well.
Look sharp and feel sharp, you choose the razor.
I like it. Yeah. We should remix.
That's going to be stuck in your head for the rest of the week now, isn't it? So if you want the comparison, we'll pop that in the show notes at theretrohour.com. Now, we're talking about this survey that Sega of Japan put up on their website. And they were asking which classic franchises fans would like to see Sega revisiting again. And quite interestingly, they've now published the results.
You see, I found this really interesting because they did this, I was saying earlier on, they did this about 8 years ago.
Yeah.
And the results are completely different. So last time, Nights into Dreams was first, and this time it's 10th. But I find that quite interesting because of the results of the last time is they did actually produce a new Nights into Dreams games for the Wii as a result, because it was like the demand was there, and Streets of Rage was like a close second.
Yeah.
Whereas Streets of Rage has come 9th this time. But number one, I don't even know what that is.
Sakura Wars.
Yeah, like, considering I'm a big Sega fanboy, I don't know Sakura Wars. Everybody's probably going, oh, as if he doesn't know that.
Well, I think, you know, they did only put this survey on the Japanese website.
Yeah.
And, I've looked it up. I'd never played it before either.
It's okay.
A game on the Saturn, but it is quite a franchise at Sega own. It looks like kind of anime kind of stuff.
Oh, okay, that makes me feel a bit better.
So, but Jet Set Radio, interestingly, second.
Yeah, you know what? I've never liked Jet Set Radio.
Okay.
I've just never been into it. I'm not saying it's a bad game or anything like that. It's just whenever I've kind of
picked
it.
Ever play Future? Jet Set Radio Future, which was the second one.
No,
it was on the Xbox, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was much easier than the first one. Yeah,
oh, okay.
It flowed a lot more.
Oh, no, it wasn't a case of I didn't find it flowing. I remember playing it and just not really getting into it. So.
It's very stylized, wasn't
it?
Yeah.
Graphics, very nice. Good soundtrack on that game as well.
Oh, yeah.
Shenmue, obviously, makes a top list here. And number five, Virtua Fighter.
Yeah.
Panzer Dragoon in there as well.
We mentioned that, didn't we?
Well, the ones that you wanted, you were after Skies of Arcadia, you mentioned that makes it here.
Yeah, Skies of Arcadia, number
and,
eight.
And number nine, Streets of Rage. Well, yeah, I was wondering what like a modern Streets of Rage would look like. And I think if Sega kind of did it, you know, they're obviously doing this new Sonic 2D game, I think.
They'd have to do it 2D.
Yeah, you couldn't have it like,
you couldn't have it 3D. They'd have to do it. It'd have to be, obviously like an Xbox Live game or something. I don't think it'd be able to be a full release these days.
Well, did you ever play Die Hard Arcade?
Yeah, Dynamite Decky.
Yeah, so Die Hard Arcade was originally supposed to be developed
There
was a mess up, wasn't there?
No.
No?
No, he's wrong. He's wrong. Don't listen to him. I know this story.
Go on, Joe.
It was Fighting Force. So Die Hard Arcade was Dynamite Decky in Japan. So very much like, you know, Super Mario 2 on NES, on the NES. And it was Dynamite Decky first. And then when it came over here, it became Die Hard Arcade, which was really bizarre because obviously Die Hard was quite an 80s franchise. Obviously, it was still running, it's still running now, but in the 90s, it wasn't as big as it was in the 80s, and then this random game of it came out. But yeah, no.
That's why we have you, Joe.
Yeah,
for
there
this
we
expertise.
Go.
Fighting Force wasn't a good game, though, was it, either?
I don't mind Fighting Force.
Oh, okay.
It's no Streets of Rage, but I quite like Fighting Force. I've played it for a few couple of times. On PS1 and Dreamcast, and I think I have played the N64 version, but it's no Streets of Rage, and there's a lot more kind of gunning in it, and obviously it's a 3D beat-em-up that, like you say, don't really work that well kind of thing.
Yeah. Didn't deserve the Streets of Rage franchise title.
No.
Well, interestingly as well, what I think is quite interesting about this is they've got the favourite Sega characters here.
Yeah.
Sonic doesn't even make the top 10.
Yeah, I think people have had enough of Sonic.
They've been burned too many times.
Yeah.
Eggman is at number 6.
Yeah.
Which is like...
Alex Kidd.
Yeah. Alex Kidd's in there. When was the last Alex Kidd game?
Was 91, 92, you know, right? Something like that.
So if you do want to check out the full results of this survey, quite interesting. I wonder where they'll go with this. I mean, I imagine they did it for a reason, so maybe some of those franchises are going to be revisited very soon.
Please, Streets of Rage, please.
But make it good.
Yeah.
We'll put those at theretrohour.com. Now, I do quite have a bit of an affinity for old school FPSs.
Yeah.
And there is a new one coming out, potentially on Steam. Apparently it's been given the green light, called Warlock Revenge.
Never heard of it.
Well, it's a new game, yeah. So, but looking at it, I mean, if there is a link here on one of our favourite news websites, indieretronews.com.
Yeah.
Actually reminds me a bit of like Heretic and Hexen, that kind of stuff.
Yeah,
it's like, or kind of early Quake, you know, the earliest Quake games.
Just a bit less... 3D, isn't it? It's kind of got that 2D look of Doom.
Yeah.
You know,
With a kind of faked 3D.
Yeah, it reminds me of the original Elder Scroll games as well. I forget what they're called, the first two, but it looks a little bit like that. There's also a game called Blood.
Okay, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Blood, yeah.
It looks really similar too.
I've been playing a few of these through recently, you know, since I modded my Sega Saturn. I was playing Hexen on there not long ago.
Yeah.
And I do, you know, they've got quite a good style about them. And, you know, I was actually, because I got, you know, I got the PlayStation 4 VR. And I was chatting to someone about what games would be good to look at in VR, and he said, imagine the original Doom in virtual reality.
But
we got that point you just said then about the characters. They kind of be like sheets of paper. They're like 2D spacing you, aren't they?
Yeah,
at the back of them,
would
be like,
actually,
you know, you're very thin. You've got to be run over by a steamroller.
Fighting cardboard cutouts.
You know what I mean? So, but it's cool to see, you know, an old school FPS again, inspired by DOS classics. So that's going to be hopefully coming to Steam very soon. And speaking of Doom, this is awesome. Doom, the original Doom, has been turned into a platforming game.
All right.
So this is called Mini Doom.
Okay.
And what they've done is they've actually kind of took the layout and the monsters and, you know, kind of the original Doom, you know, playthrough, and they've actually made it into a 2D side-on platforming game.
It looks awesome, actually.
Well, you were talking before about, you know, the fact that Duke Nukem started, didn't it, as a platforming game?
Yeah, the first two Duke Nukems were for, like, DOS, weren't they?
Yeah.
But this looks really cool. They've kind of got some really nice fire effects and stuff in there.
You know what it looks like? To me, it looks like the Angry Video Game nerd game.
Yeah, yeah. I can see that, actually.
It's on Steam, actually. Yeah. I've not played them myself.
But, yeah, no, I never played it. I saw some footage. It looked pretty good.
Yeah, it looks good. Yeah.
So, this would be great on mobile, I reckon.
Yeah, probably won't get the backing, though. How is it we always come back to Doom? We always come back to Doom. Like
everything comes back to Doom.
Yeah, Virtual Fighter even popped up again, because I'm on. It has to pop up.
But at the moment, this Mini Doom, it's a free download as well, available for Windows. It looks a fun little game. Apparently, it's only like, you know, I think it's only like one level or five stages at the moment, so quite short. But yeah, it looks a bit of fun, free download. And this is another game that was one of my favourites back in the old days, and I'm actually quite staggered by how good this looks. Now, we did mention when this it appeared on the forum that Pinball Dreams, which you might remember, it was Digital Illusions, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
And they did Pinball Fantasies as well, out on like the Amiga.
It was that 21st Century Entertainment, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And well, that was Houston turned it in there, didn't they?
Yeah.
And it came out on, like, you know, loads of platforms back then. The Jaguar even had a port of it, didn't it?
Oh, really?
But they've actually ported this game, Pinball Dreams, which was the first one in the series, to the 8-bit Amstrad CPC. Now, when I read that, it's a group called Batman Group. And if you look at the video they've just released of the gameplay on it, my jaw dropped when I saw that was running on an Amstrad. It's got, like, the proper, you know, vertical scrolling. It looks really smooth. It's got, you know, all the bumpers and everything are there. There's nothing taken away from this game. Obviously, the colour depth is a bit lower than the, you know, the 16 and 32-bit machines, but I'll pop this video in our show notes. You've got to give this a watch because it looks so impressive. And they've actually released, like, you know, 5 to 10 minute little preview of it.
Well, do you know Batman Group's history? They're the one that did that amazing demo, Batman Valve, which was for the 500, which was like a whole beautiful animations of Batman and the whole city. And
okay.
They digitized all the images. So these guys are really on it with coding. And by the look of this, the ball physics, I don't think you'd be able to maintain those ball physics on an 8-bit machine.
Yeah, well, that is absolutely
quite smooth.
I knew that the CPC, like, you know, had some, like, good graphics modes and stuff like that, but I think often a lot of the time it got Spectrum ports, didn't it?
Yeah.
So, but you're looking at this now and, like, you know, that's the best I've seen on that machine ever. And the fact that, you know, people are still squeezing extra power out of a 30-year-old machine is just insane.
It's just like they've kind of stepped down in res a little bit.
Yeah, but you know, if you squint a bit or look through Ravi's glasses, you know. So, yeah, we'll pop all of that in our show notes at theretrohour.com. And thank you for checking out episode number 47. We'll be out again next Friday. And, of course, you can get it from all your favourite podcast clients. If you do listen on iTunes, please do leave a review.
Yeah, we were top 10 last week.
Yeah, we were, actually, weren't we? With Stuart Chaffee.
Yeah.
Good guess, wasn't he? And speaking of good guess,
we've got Steve Turner from GraphGold.
Now, he's going to be coming up for the next 40 minutes. The inside story of all those classic games of Rainbow Islands conversion, Iridium 2, Fire and Ice, working with Telecomsoft, Sega, Virgin. This is definitely one, if you grew up playing those games in the 80s and 90s, you're going to enjoy. Here he is, Steve Turner on the Retro Hour, and we'll see you next week.
Ciao.
Thanks for listening.
You're listening to the Retro Hour podcast. Just want to give a big shout to Dave Garside as well, who actually suggested this week's interview. If maybe you've got a hero in the video gamers industry that you'd love to hear on the show, why don't you drop us a quick tweet at Retro Hour UK? We will try and sort it out. And now it's time to get the inside story on games like Fire and Ice, Rainbow Islands, how you do arcade conversions, working with some of the biggest gaming companies in the 80s and 90s. Welcome to the Retro Hour podcast, Steve Turner, formerly of Graft Gold. Thank thank you for coming on.
It's a pleasure.
Well, we're going to get some of your stories from your amazing history in the world of video games. We thought it might be quite good to start all the way back at the beginning, though. What was your first gaming experience? Where did it all begin for you?
Well, my first computer was a ZX80. And for gaming, it was a bit of a disappointment because every time you made it do something, the screen went blank. I spent ages working out how the machine actually worked and disassembling the ROM in the days before you could buy books on that, and I was doing it all by hand. And I worked out if I got the timing right, I could actually get graphics onto the screen, and I did manage to get a single asteroid going across the screen. And the very next week, I saw an ad for the ZX81, and that completely blew everything that I was doing out the water.
But even back then, I mean, just getting something on the TV must have been amazing.
Oh, it was. I mean, I had the same feel as everyone else, of, you know, even in BASIC, printing up your name and then printing graphics in BASIC and whatever. I did try a little submarine game in BASIC, and that was a kind of grid-based game where you gave orders to your submarine and you had to say whether it surfaced or not. I just ran out of memory before I could get enough lines of BASIC in, because I only had the 16K spectrum at that point.
Yeah, so would you be kind of rushing to the arcades to look for games rather than the ZX81?
We didn't have arcades as such in Witham, Essex. It's a kind of rural town. But what we did have was lots of pubs, and each pub had a single arcade machine. So on a Friday night and Saturday night, and that's how I met Andrew, we used to go around with a group of lads, kind of almost doing a pub crawl, not so much for the beer, but to play different arcade machines.
What kind of games did you play in there then? Do you have any titles that you remember?
There was one with a racing car used to go around the track, and one to three cars used to come in the opposite direction. And I played that until I turned the score back to zero. I could get through every level, and you had to go around the whole sequence of screens a couple of times to do that. And it was really disappointing. When it reset to zero, there was no sign that we'd achieved anything at all, and I never played that machine ever again.
As a gamer, that was always disappointing, you know, when you finished a game and didn't even get a little well done message or something.
Yeah, that's right. And you know, because we didn't get a high score or anything, the machine just, because we wondered what would happen when it would run out of digits. You know, we thought, oh, you know, maybe there's an Easter egg or something nice would happen. And it was just a total disappointment.
So how did you kind of learn to program yourself and like make games then? Was that kind of an attempt to make, you know, better games than you'd seen already?
It was, because I was a professional programmer. I used to program kind of commercial systems in both assembly and COBOL, but there was no kind of moving graphics. The best we had was an IBM terminal, which you could sort of display a static graphic on. And that's kind of how I came about meeting Andrew, because I had a friend in the company that knew Andrew. He said, oh, this guy actually gets moving pictures on his terminals and he programs these games at work. And I was really interested in that, so he brought a great big stack of punch cards along, and we tried to get the operators to load them up when they had a sort of spare moment. But unfortunately, we didn't have I think it was a kick system, the big operating system then, and we just didn't have that. The correct version, so we never got that working. But in a roundabout way, that introduced me to Andrew for the first time.
And were you coding games at that time, or were you coding something else?
I was thinking about games. I desperately wanted to do something other than like spend the rest of my life. It was an insurance firm, and you know, it was programming is interesting, but the end result was pretty boring. And I started reading about micros in magazines, and I kept thinking, there's got to be a way into this. And when I saw the first games in magazines, I'm thinking, wow, I like them on the arcade machines. I reckon I could do this. If there's a machine with enough of the capabilities, you know, I've got enough ideas to be able to do it better.
Was that kind of a nervous decision to make? So I imagine with video games being quite new, you probably didn't really know how long the industry was going to last for or how big it was going to be.
No, I mean, I'd actually finished and signed my first game with Houston before I handed in my notice. And because I knew I wanted to do this, I saved a whole year's salary. So I knew that even if I just spent the way I was spending before when I had a job, I could last a year if I got no income at all. But so I thought, right, it's worth the gamble. And my firm made it clear, well, if I want to come back, you know, they'd welcome me with open arms. So I felt sort of safe. And I thought, well, if it only lasts a year, it's a nice holiday.
You did it a lot more sensibly than many people around that time who, you know, just kind of got all the money, then blew it all in like 6 months.
Yeah, well, I had a wife and my first child, Mark, who I think he was about 2 years old then, sort of toddling around. So you know, I had sort of responsibilities and a mortgage because I was a bit older than your average kind of programmer at that time. Mm-hmm. But what I had was my industry background. I'd had formal training as a programmer and as a systems analyst, and what I did, I applied that to gaming. So rather than a sort of slapdash approach, I kind of designed the code, and that I think gave me a bit of an advantage in trying to squeeze a lot into the machine and get it working in short time.
Now, you went on to form ST Software, and you were using a system. The platform was Dragon 32. Why did you choose this machine?
Dragon 32 came from Andrew's dad, because when Andrew heard that I was programming on the Spectrum, he went away and borrowed his dad's Dragon 32 and started just copying what he remembered of my program. And then one night after the pub, when we went round his house for a cup of coffee, out came this, and he showed me my program running on a Dragon 32, and I was very impressed. So what happened, Andrew got his own Dragon 32. I bought a second-hand for him, and he came along to work for me. And when he, at the beginning, his games weren't selling, but he used to write some of the software to assist me. So he wrote a little graphics editor. That was one of our first little utilities on the Dragon 32. I was still punching in hex on my computer for the graphics before he did that, and I was still punching in hex for the machine code. Quasitron, I think, was the first time I used an assembler. Because I just couldn't get one. I tried a few out, like the Hisoft assembler, straight away, and they just seemed corny to me, because by the time you got the assembler loaded up onto the machine, there was hardly any room for your source code.
Well, the Dragon 32 was quite an interesting platform. Wasn't that compatible with the Tandy as well?
I think it was, because they both had, if I remember right, the same kind of four-colour graphics.
Yeah.
On the screen. And I mean, what's nice about it, it was a proper computer, you know, with proper keyboard, whereas next to it, the Spectrum, well, I love the Spectrum, I mean, it looked like a toy.
that rubber keyboard wasn't the nicest to code on, I imagine.
No, I mean, I soon bought a proper keyboard for it and mounted the Spectrum board inside of it. But the problem is all these like little extensions seem to have their own nuances. And well, one keyboard I ordered plugged on the back of the Spectrum board, and then you had to put your other things like your Kempston joystick and your printer interface on the back of that. So you had a kind of daisy chain of these connectors. And it was actually changing assembler instructions. Like I traced a load A with I, and it came out load A with R, a completely different instruction. And I phoned up the guys who manufactured the keyboard and told them about it. I said, oh, no, we just did a standard interface like anything else. And I could never work out how it could actually change instructions, other than that I knew one of the bits in the instruction was changing by the time it got to the CPU.
That could have messed up your code as well, couldn't it?
Well, absolutely. I just couldn't run code on it. But nearly everything that we bought didn't work with anything else. Like, I bought a disk drive, and that didn't work with the disassembler. So, and the disassembler wouldn't work with the printer. So I had to reverse engineer the disassembler and fit it together with the printer. Then I had to do the same thing with the disk drive and patch the disk drive in. In the end, I got the system so I could save on a disk drive, print on the printer and disassemble. And that took a hell of a lot of reverse engineering and work, but at least that gave me a kind of workable way of doing things.
It's crazy to think the amount of effort you had to go through back then just to get, you know, simple things like that working. I mean, you know, you think about the Sinclair machines, and I remember like the dreaded RAM pack wobble. You know, if you knocked it, the machine would crash. And
that was terrible, and it was really upsetting. If you'd spent kind of half an hour just keying in mindless hex codes in a REM statement, and then boom, the machine goes blank. But sometimes I used to get so upset, but my wife used to come in and retype them for me. I can remember having a coat hanger on the back of the machine, kind of bent to clamp all the gubbins on the back of the machine to the Spectrum. But that problem largely disappeared once I got everything mounted into the keyboard. And of course, by then, I'd bought a board with the 48K in rather than having the expansion pack, which helped, because it was the expansion pack that seemed, because it stood up at the back of the machine, that was the thing that wobbled the most.
Yeah, so you were kind of working with the Spectrum at the time as well, and you also started doing some stuff for the C64?
Yeah, well, Andrew was working on the Dragon, copying my programs at first, and unfortunately, Dragon must have gone bust, but the shops, instead of taking any titles that were in process, said, oh, right, straight away, they're not going to sell any more Dragon titles because they've already got so many. And it was a mistake, because titles had a shelf life of weeks in those days. So it's a mistake to say, oh, we don't want any new titles because we've already got enough. You have to keep flushing them through, and there was enough Dragon 32 owners to kind of take new titles. But unfortunately, our titles sold in the hundreds rather than the tens of thousands. So Andrew said, look, there's a nice new machine my mate's got called the Commodore 64. I'll convert the latest game into that, which was Lunatac. And that's how we got into the Commodore 64.
Well, how did ST software change into GraphGold then?
That was probably the time that Avalon was coming out, and Andrew's games, I think, had just started selling, and I suddenly realised I'm going to be earning a lot of money in one calendar year, and the tax system meant that you'd be absolutely fleeced if you do that, because you just went up into kind of super tax. And I had a chat with my accountant, and he said, look, what you need to do is to form a limited company, because a limited company, if it's small enough, all you do is get charged 25% per year, and then the capital's in the company, and then you pay yourself wages over that. So if you have a good year, you don't pay it all in tax. You've got it ready to pay yourself for any bad years that follow. And it was jolly good advice. So he had a look, and he had two off-the-shelf computer companies, and he said, well, you know, which one do you want? There's one called GraphGold. I thought, oh, that sounds good, because US Gold was around at the time. I thought, oh, you know, it's sort of hints of that. And he said to me and Andrew, well, you know, you don't have to stick with that name. I'll give you a week to change the name before I activate the registration. But we couldn't think of anything better, so the name stuck.
And in hindsight, though, what a perfect name, because, you know, it was remembered for, like, you know, decades on, isn't it, that name?
Yes, it was. And I mean, if you look up graft in the dictionary, unfortunately, it has like one connotation, which means something like results by illicit means. Which, but it's main sort of thing. I mean, a graft is a sort of unit of work. I think when they used to dig trenches, a graft was one man's work of the trench per day, something like that. So it stands sort of for hard work. So, you know, I always read it, it's creating something gold out of hard work. And it kind of matched what we were doing, because it was really hard in those days. It wasn't people kind of used to say to me, oh, yeah, all you do is sit around and play games all day. And no, we didn't. I probably played less games then than I'd ever done in my life. We got our nose to the grindstone and were either keying in, debugging, or working out how to do the next thing. And, it was the hardest I'd ever worked in my life.
You worked a lot with Houston Consultants. How did this relationship start?
I had a look at the magazines when I had my first game sort of demo, and I thought, let's look through and see which magazine adverts take my eye. And I picked out three, which were Quiksilver, Silversoft and Hewson. And they were the only ones in those days that were doing full-page adverts. And I thought, you know, if an outfit is really serious, that's what they'd be doing. They're the big guys. And I sent my little demo tape off to all three. Quiksilver, I think it was Rod Cousins, who was the only one to send the polite refusal. Please send us other games, but we're not particularly interested in this one kind of letter. And both Hewson and Quiksilver invited me up to meet them, and both offered me a contract.
What was Andrew like then when you first met him?
Very like me in some ways. He'd been to the same school, spookily enough, in Rayleigh. I think he was just a couple of years older, so I never knew him at school, but he had this sort of scientific background, which I'd done all the sciences at school, but never kind of pursued it after. So we kind of hit it off, I think, pretty much immediately. And because he'd kind of played around with code, it was obvious to me he wasn't kind of like a businessman who knew nothing about games. You could talk to him about the struggle that you're having with the machine, and he kind of understood what you were going through. I wanted to be with someone that kind of didn't bring my games down with kind of substandard games. You know, he was sort of in the lucky position of being able to pick and choose the best from all the tapes that were sent him.
Well, speaking of quality, Uridium is considered one of the best shooters on the Commodore 64. Did he have to use many tricks to get that performance out of the system?
It was Andrew's kind of aim to do a game that was just like an arcade game. What he did, he designed the whole game around that. So he worked out how much he could scroll on the machine, which was limited to the sort of centre portion, and he faked the rest by moving kind of stars and things like that. He timed out how many sprites that he could get on the machine. And once he got all these timings, he designed the game to fit all the constraints that he had. And that's what led to him being able to run it at full frame rate. And that was his aim. He knew to get that kind of arcade smoothness and that feel, you needed to run it at full frame rate. And I can't remember any other games that were doing that at the time. It was a real step forward.
Yeah, I think even now, I played that game not long ago, and it still looks incredible that, you know, like you said, it's that arcade quality on an 8-bit home computer. It was unheard of at the time.
That's right. And when he started, I had my doubts, and I was thinking, you know, is this going to be possible? But it sort of shows that if you kind of design something for the capabilities and that fits hand in glove with what a machine can do, you can really push it. And that was the genius of Andrew, to be able to recognise what that machine could do and to kind of just get the game to kind of fit that envelope.
Well, the music on Uridium as well is often considered one of the best on the C64. I mean, did that take a lot of work, and did you enjoy using the SID chip?
I did, because all I'd done up to then is write stuff on the Spectrum. I can't even remember doing it on the Dragon. Andrew must have taken my music data and just kind of put it in. But Uridium was the first time I actually used a music package. He had this free program which came with his Commodore 64, and it just you keyed notes on a music stave. And I thought, well, this is interesting. I'll try and use it. So I had my guitar on the lap, and I kind of worked out things and then keyed it straight on the stave. And it all came together in about half an hour. I started off with thinking about the Star Wars theme and thinking, yeah, that sort of goes at the beginning. And yeah, let's get a big old orchestral crash, and in my head I had like a full John Williams orchestra going on. But it doesn't quite sound like that on the C64, but it kind of got the right idea using the kind of thick notes that it could do.
Well, another publisher that you started working with was Telecomsoft. How did that come about?
Well, after a few years with Hewson, things sort of started going awry. We knew Dominic and John at Hewson, and also other staff there. We were having phone call after phone call saying, look, something's up here. The bills aren't being paid. The things fall into pieces. There's rows all the time. We haven't been paid at the end of the month, all that kind of stuff. And finally, one of their staff moved to Telecoms Soft. And we had a phone call saying, look, you can ignore me if you want, but your game is just going to be sub-licensed to another publisher. But I suggest you come and talk to us at Telecomsoft, because I've moved to Telecomsoft. I'm no longer at Hewson's, and we'd like to talk about publishing your games. And so we went along, and we were filled with this horror story of that Hewson's not going to be around, you know, in a couple of weeks' time. And that was corroborated by John and Dominic at Hewson ringing us up. They both rang up and said, look, can we have a job at Graft Gold? Because we don't think we're going to have jobs for long. So the whole thing looked as though it was falling down like a pack of cards. So I thought I was taking the sensible position, and I signed with Telecomsoft. And the thing which I kind of regret doing now, because it just didn't work out, they said, look, we've got a big legal team. We don't think Hewson's going to be around to publish your games. You've got no contract with the two games that you're currently writing, because both Andrew and me had a game that was near completion. Let us publish those games. Our legal team will fight, and basically you'll get the games published. And it just seemed to me like a no-brainer and no option. But as it turned out into a court case. Hewson was rescued. I mean, Hewson is a very good businessman. I mean, he does accountancy now, and he managed by the skin of his teeth to hold on. And it surprised us, because all his staff were saying, it's the end, Joe, that there's no hope. And he managed to bounce back. But unfortunately, then our games were being published by Telecomsoft. A court case started. The legal team of Telecomsoft didn't seem to deliver what they said they would, like getting our games kind of published without a big battle. In the end, I don't even know what happened, because I think there was a settlement out of court to which we weren't party to. But it took absolutely ages. And what it did, it alienated Graft Gold to all the magazines, because they were sort of cup in hand with Hewson. Hewson was very, very good at publicity, and Telecomsoft not so. So when it came to the magazines publishing anything to do with it, I mean, we were getting slated by the press at the time. It was a real kind of about turn for us, because up till then, we couldn't do anything wrong with the press.
Do you think that was to do with the fact that it was, you know, obviously it was owned by British Telecom as well, wasn't it? And I imagine there was a lot more red tape and, you know, much bigger company.
I think so. And they kind of started off okay with us, but it soon became clear, well, they had no intention of staying in the industry and were looking to sell out, and they sold out to Microprose. It's just sort of what was happening at the time. The smaller companies were being swallowed up by larger companies, and the developers were having a rough time. If you had a game in process, you weren't sure whether it's going to be taken by the new company, what's going to happen. It was our first kind of experience of the kind of publisher turmoil, and that really didn't finish. That was just the start of it for us. We went through a series over the next 3 years of something like five publishers either selling out to someone else or shutting up shop completely, like Mirrorsoft. And after that, my policy was, well, I won't stay with one publisher. I'll make sure that I've got at least three on the go, which made us even more prone to publishers' disasters, because the more you have, the more risk there is of them going down. But at least I always had another iron in the fire. But there was one year when every single product that we had was published by a different publisher from the one we started the game off with. And some of them, of course, died by the wayside. And that was a dreadful time for Graft Gold. And it was so demoralising for staff when you've worked, say, a year on a game, and then you know it's not going to be published.
Well, one of the interesting things about Telecomsoft was that they had the Taito licences
for arcade games. So you started doing a lot of arcade conversions, and really good quality arcade conversions as well.
That's right, and that's really how we started our life with Telecom Soft. As part of the deal, they wanted us to finish the two games that we were doing for Hewson's and let Telecom Soft publish them. But because they wanted me to employ Dominic and John, and they said, look, we've got Flying Shark we need doing urgently. Do you think you can do it in 6 weeks? If you can, we'll inject some capital into the company, which kind of gives you a boot and starts you off. And that just sort of seemed too good an offer. So I had a word with John and Dominic, and we went and had a look at Flying Shark. And we thought it's going to be difficult, but yeah, we think we can do it. And that's what happened. So we moved to our first sort of offices outside my house, a funny little office on the top of a veg store, and had a crash course in copying an arcade game. We learned how to do that very quickly, and we always did it in the same way. We videoed the whole of the game. We learned how to play it, videoed it from one end to the other, and then John Cumming used the video to redraw the graphics and plotted out all the kind of courses of the meanies, and Dominic did the engine that ran it. I converted the Spectrum version onto the Amstrad in, I think it took me 6 days, and so I had little time to muck about. So I basically took his code, squashed it onto the Amstrad, got John to redo the graphics for me, and the main thing that I had to rewrite were all the graphics machine routines and to write a sound routine, which I had prepared ready. And very quickly, I got the whole thing up and running.
Well, your technique obviously worked. I mean, you know, one of the most polished arcade conversions ever would be the Rainbow Islands conversion that you did. I mean, was a lot? That must have been a lot of work going into that, because that was, you know, that was quite an intensive arcade game, wasn't it? There was a lot going on in that game.
It was, and we took that on really because we wanted to get into the 16-bit market in a big way. And Dominic was playing around on the Atari and the Amiga, and he'd written a kind of games operating system for us already, but he was struggling to come up with kind of game ideas. He had a lot of real fine demos, but no game. And then we had the opportunity to do the conversion, and it was great because Andrew was stuck for something to do at the time. So I said to Andrew, do you want to lead this project? You do that, and you can actually work on the 16-bit machines, because he was absolutely dying to write on the 16-bit machines, whereas up to that point, Telecom Soft were only interested in us producing 8-bit games. And it was probably our first big team game. The Flying Shark, because it was just across the Spectrum and the Amstrad, there was only about three of us working on that. Rainbow Island was the first game where we put virtually the company on the game, and had people doing all different versions. And I was probably one of the only people who didn't play a major part in. I was kind of managing them, but I was still working on 8-bit games for Telecom Soft.
Do you remember when the reviews of Rainbow Islands came out then? That must have been a good read when you saw those come out in the magazines.
It was, and it was kind of mixed for us, because about the time, there was a guy called Derek de la Fuente who came, and he absolutely raved about the game to us, so we knew it they'd be good, and he got the first reviews into magazines. So they were just coming out when we heard about the Telecom Soft sale to Microprose, and something went wrong with Microprose and Taito. I heard a story that someone at Microprose had marched into the Taito office very bullshit and said, oh, we own all the rights, you know, we're going to publish this, and they promptly said, no, you're not, and wouldn't talk to them. So our game, which was getting rave reviews at the time, just looked as though it would never be published. We at the time were doing a little bit of work for Probe, for Fergus McGovern, and Fergus McGovern just happened to talk to me about Rainbow, and I said, oh, yeah, it's a shame it's never going to get released. And he was saying, that can't be. It's just such a good game. It'd just be a travesty if that's not released. And he got Ocean interested and got everybody kind of talking to each other, and Ocean did the deal with Microprose, and so finally we got it released via Ocean.
Well, another game that you got released under Virgin this time was Realms, which was one of the very first real-time strategy games.
Yeah, that's a game that I'm kind of proud of, because that was our first team original game. Before, when we did original games, like one programmer would kind of write the game and then other people would convert it onto the machines. But this was a game that was conceived as it's got to work on the ST, the Amiga and the PC. So we set out writing it on those machines from the outset, and we had a team of artists working on it and a team of programmers, and which I kind of managed. And it really worked. It kind of showed that we'd kind of adapted to kind of working as a larger unit rather than individuals. And it was a nice feeling when we did that, because one person would be writing one bit and another the other bit on the different machines, and then we'd swap over and the programmers would convert each other's work.
Well, I know around that time, you know, if you're talking the ST and the Amiga, piracy, a lot of developers say, was a huge problem on those platforms. How did you work to defeat piracy, or what measures did you guys take?
Not a lot. We kind of admitted that we didn't have the expertise or the time to beat the pirates, because the pirates were working full-time trying to crack anti-piracy systems. So we always said to the publishers, look, you need an anti-piracy expert to do that side of it. And we used to just fit their systems onto our program. I think for Realms, Virgin used the old look up the manual kind of technique, so at least you had to have a photocopy of the whole manual.
And if anything, though, that, you know, people that actually bought the game were the ones that had to go through the effort of doing that. The pirates just, like, skipped it, didn't they?
That's right. It always annoyed us, because at the end of the day, it's sort of money in our pocket that's going. But I kind of was sympathetic in the way that I thought the shelf price of games was far too high, because we used to get 80p per game for a 16-bit game, and then there was on the shelf for £25. And I'm thinking, how can it be inflated so much when most of the work is actually done by us, yet we only get that tiny little portion as a royalty? And it seemed to me that the game still should be around about the 5-6 quid mark, and everyone could make the profit off it, and they'd sell more.
That was always the excuse that the pirates used, wasn't it, that the games were too expensive on the Amiga and ST?
Yeah, I think it kind of went out of people's pocket money range, and it was too much, really. And it showed you in the sale. We just didn't have the sales figures there, and we couldn't contemplate an Amiga-only game, and that's what Andrew always wanted to do. So we always had to design things for the limitations of the ST.
Well, one game that absolutely blew my mind when it came out was Fire and Ice, and the sound, the graphics on that, and just the sliding on the ice and everything. It was just such a good platformer.
Andrew was partnered with Philip, who was a YTS programmer, artist that I'd taken on straight from school. And at the time, I couldn't afford to compete with the rest of the industry for the sort of best around. So I basically looked at newcomers. I don't think Philip had done hardly anything on a computer at all, but he bought some paintings that he'd done, and I said, I like the light and shade. This guy knows how to do light and shade. He's going to be good on the computer. And he sat at the screen and he did a fish, I think it was, and you could immediately see it look round and whatever. But he had his own sort of character, which he got in the game, and it went very well with Andrew's kind of fun that he likes in games, and that they really gelled as a team for that game. And I was very sorry to leave Phil. In part, it was due to a guy from one of our publishers came along and he said in front of Philip, "Oh, I see it as Andrew and his assistant." And yeah, it wasn't like that. Philip was coming up with graphics that were so fun that Andrew, you know, and Andrew hadn't asked for them. And he'd say, "Oh, yeah, that's really good. We'll put that in." So it was Philip that was actually generating the game ideas just from the graphical angle. Although the genius of Andrew was to be able to work that into the game. So I saw it as a very well kind of matched team. But Philip didn't like kind of being sidelined like that. And in the end, he got an offer, unfortunately, from Fergus McGovern, which is perhaps why he helped us out with the Ocean deal with Rainbow Islands. Although I can't remember what happened twice, but he made Phil an offer and Phil went to work for him, you know, which was a shame. So one of my best artists was poached.
Well, the character of Cool Coyote, I mean, you know, obviously around that time there was Sonic the Hedgehog and kind of, you know, was it a conscious effort to kind of make a cool kind of animal character?
It was. It started off as a bunny rabbit, and it didn't kind of work because Phil did this bunny that had quite a large sort of pot belly, which kind of flopped as he jumped around, and it just looked like a little bit gross. But we took that to Mirrorsoft, and they kind of liked the concept. But the thing that they really liked, we had this, and it was daft because all it was a demo, and it ended up as the bit at the beginning of the game with Cool Coyote playing the piano.
Oh yeah,
to the music. And Jason had done this excellent soundtrack, and they signed the game on the strength of Andrew's name and the coyote playing the piano, and then he became the main character.
I just loved the whole graphics, like the reflections in the water and everything. And the Christmas special as well. That was a great one.
I mean, Andrew had a real sort of attention to detail. You know, it used to worry me as the one paying the wages because he just always wanted to go the nth bit extra to kind of do something. Like, not only would he put, say, shell cases of bullets in a game, he'd want to put shadows of the shell cases of bullets, and, you know, it all takes extra programming time, but it was that kind of attention to detail in his games that kind of made them stand out.
Well, there was meant to be an enhanced version for the Mega Drive. What happened there?
It's a sorry tale, really. We always had a problem with Sega because Cool Coyote was blue and their main character Sonic was blue, so they wanted to change the colour of him. But we said, oh yeah, we'll make him orange. But then there was another game with a fox around that was orange, so we were having problems there. But what happened, Virgin, who was working with us on another game, took the cover disc off. There was a demo on the front of one of the Amiga magazines, and they took it to Sega and said, look, we'd like to publish this game. And when we went with Renegade to see Sega, they said, oh, no, you can't submit it because it's already been submitted. And so we weren't allowed to submit our own game because a publisher who had nothing to do with the game had taken a cover disc and submitted it to Sega.
That's weird. That's really odd.
So that led to a row between Renegade and Virgin. In the end, I did manage to kind of talk them into sort of meetings, saying, okay, well, if Virgin have got the license with Sega and you've got the license from us, we all need to sit down and talk with it, and, you know, we'll have to accept that's the way it's going to be. And we did get the Master System version agreed and through Virgin, and that went ahead. But the Mega Drive system, we actually finished it all. It was just never published, and I never knew why, but I guess that somewhere along the lines, like, the deal just couldn't be made, and unfortunately it was such that if Dan didn't agree with Virgin and Sega, if they couldn't get the deal together, Sega weren't going to take it from Renegade directly, so it would be buried.
Well, I remember around you know, the early 90s, you actually brought back one of your older titles. Euridium got a sequel on the Amiga, Euridium 2. How did you go about updating that game then?
It wasn't easy because Andrew always knew it was such an iconic game. he was kind of worried about doing it, especially on the ST, but it was something that he was also burning to do. He pleaded and pleaded, can he make it an Amiga-only game, which I wasn't keen to do. But I can't remember in the end whether we actually did do it on the Atari. I got the feeling in the end we decided, well, it's only going to work because of the scrolling. It's only really going to be any good on the Amiga. So we'd concentrate on that one. And if at all we can do it on the Atari, that would just have to be a kind of port and do it as best as we could.
Yeah, it only came out on the Amiga looking at this, so you must not have gone ahead with the Atari version.
No, I think there's... Because it just didn't have the support for the scroll, it was kind of, it just didn't really work. But I think the Atari sales were dropping off anyway, so Renegade thought, OK, we'll go ahead with the Amiga. And also, we did a CD32 version, which was the definitive version of it. But unfortunately, I don't think that was ever released. We did hand over a master for that. So we did all the work, and that had extra kind of backgrounds. We also did a CD32 Fire and Ice, with all extra pictures in the background.
Have you, is there any of these, unreleased versions of, like, Iridium on the CD32? Have you still got those in your archives anywhere?
I don't think so. I can't remember what happened to them at the end, because we had everything on DAC tape, and somewhere I've got some DAC tapes, but our DAC tape reader kind of went when Graph Gold was wound up, so I never had the ability to look and see what was there, but it would have been on there somewhere.
I know that even now, the Amiga's got a big community. If something like that got uncovered eventually, that would be amazing.
For Fire and Ice, I can't remember how far that they actually got, but if Emma Cubley did all the background layers, because we added this sort of backdrop into the thing to make it nicer, and she did all these pictures for the kind of scenario pictures for the levels, which she drew all in ink pens, which were really nice. So they worked very well for that.
Well, another title that you did on the Mega Drive was Otifants, which was a very odd title. It was by a German comedian.
Oh, that's right, yeah. He actually came over in a helicopter one day and sort of landed at a hotel a few miles out of Witham and came into the office to have a look at the main character to check that we were doing it to his specifications. And he'd sit with the graphic artist and say, oh, no, yeah, that pixel there's wrong. he didn't like the fact that the artist had made him a little bit more 3D because it was a video game and he wanted to take all the light and shade off of him. The artist sort of flattened him out, but I think it went back afterwards because it just wouldn't compete against other video games.
Did they have a TV show as well? I heard it was...
They did, and we signed up because Sega come to us and said, look, we need this game, we need it really quickly. Do you think you can do it in about 6 weeks? We said, well, a bit longer than that, but we're doing that. They spent 4 weeks getting the contract to us. And I was saying, well, you better get the contract to us because this end day, you're making it an impossible task for us. But we based it, we used all the Fire and Ice code and turned it into another game, basically, to get the game out really quickly.
And I know they had quite big hopes for that game, didn't they?
Yeah. What they told us was the TV show was going to be shown on UK networks and was going to be bigger than The Simpsons, because it was the same sort of thing about this little guy from this little elephant family that got up to all these kind of adventures. But it never got onto British tellies. So unfortunately, our game just had no UK market whatsoever because no one knew what this little elephant was.
Quirky little title when you look back, though, isn't it?
it was. The game worked very well. We thought, what can we do with a little elephant car? I just thought, let's get him to shoot jelly beans out of his trunk. We had a lot of fun doing it, but there was a lot of late nights, and Eldon Lewis was the programmer who took it on, using Andrew's code. Andrew was sort of supporting him. And, it almost sort of... He was working through the night, so he just sort of became a wreck by the end of it.
Well, getting towards the end of Graph Gold then, how did it all end then? What was the story?
We were working on a major title for... Renegade got bought by Warner when they set up a company, and they offered us something like £1 million to do a revised version of Avalon Dragon Talk in kind of 3D. It looked really brilliant. It stopped their office when we took them a demo, and we started hiring staff to get man the team out to do all the versions that they wanted. And about 3 months into the project, I just got a phone call saying, oh, sorry, Warner want to reduce their profile, and yours is one of the games that we're going to stop doing. From that moment, we were fighting for survival. I did manage to survive, I think, another couple of years, but we just didn't have enough money to put into a large game. And in the end, I threw in the towel and sold the majority of the shares to a company called Perfect, who did the Discworld adventure games. And they looked a nice little outfit, and they weren't too big. They seemed to have the technology that we didn't, like a network and whatever. The idea was they'd refinance us, but they did get a network put in place, but it never really happened as we thought it would.
It's sad that it did finish, but you did leave us with an amazing legacy of games, you know, through the 8-bit and 16-bit era, Steve. And it's, you know, it's been amazing catching up with you and talking about these games that Ravi and I both played when we were kids, and getting the inside stories.
It was a fantastic 15 years. And, you know, the amazing thing is that people are still talking about it. We thought that these games would have, you know, a couple of months' life and no one would remember them. But it's just not so. And it, you know, it's a great pleasure to speak to people who kind of remember us and what we did and appreciate it, because at the end of the day, that's really what we did it for. We did it because we liked programming and we wanted to show others and let them enjoy it. We did that more than the money. For the money, the money just let us carry on doing it, you know, but more important was we did something that we wanted.